Hello again, Planeswalkers. This is Eric from Bane Alley Magic, bringing you another Commander video. Today I'm experimenting with a mini-series I'm going to call Top 10 Underrated Cards. And this first episode, we are going to talk about my Top 10 Underrated Black Cards. These are all cards that I have played and tested out and found that they work great, but I hardly see anyone running them. So I think more people should be running these cards in their black decks. Again, these are the top 10 underrated black cards. I'm not trying to say these are my top 10 black cards of all time, or that these cards are super powerful or busted. I'm just trying to say they're underrated. So a card might go higher or lower on the list because of how powerful it is, or it might go higher on the list because of how underrated it is. So let's start off with some honorable mentions, of which we have four. The first is Fated Return. It is 4 and 3 black for an instant. Put target creature card from a graveyard onto the battlefield under your control. It gains indestructible. If it's your turn, scry 2. I think this card is great because besides the high mana cost, it does everything you want a reanimation spell to do. You reanimate a creature at instant speed, and that creature gains indestructible. And not just until the end of the turn, it just stays indestructible. If you do cast it on your own turn, you get to scry 2. But this spell is instant speed, and if you wait till the end step of the turn before yours to cast it, the creature you reanimate will be able to attack right away. So, again, Fated Return will reanimate a creature at instant speed and give it indestructible. Other reanimation spells are great, and they can still get you the best creature from any graveyard. Fated Return not only gets you the best creature, but it makes that creature even better than before. It didn't make the list because of the high mana cost, but I still love it. Next honorable mention is Twilight Prophet. 2 and 2 black for a 2/4 vampire cleric with flying and ascend. At the beginning of your upkeep, if you have the city's blessing, reveal the top card of your library and put it into your hand. Each opponent loses X life and you gain X life, where X is that card's converted mana cost. What makes this card special is that unlike other black draw card spells, which cost you life, Twilight Prophet actually gains you life. Not only does she gain you life, but she also drains your opponents. Yes, you need the city's blessing, but that is really not hard to get in Commander. On top of card draw, life gain, and life drain, you also get a high toughness flyer, so it's a good blocker that can survive for a while. Twilight Prophet didn't make the list because I'm just assuming it's not as underrated as the other cards. It should be in every Edgar Markov deck for sure, but I still think it is underrated and underplayed, so that's why it got an honorable mention. Next we have Imp's Mischief. 1 and a black for an instant. Change the target of target spell with a single target. You lose life equal to that spell's converted mana cost. This spell can do many things, from redirecting a removal spell, changing the player who takes extra turns, and it can even act like a counterspell against counterspells because of how the stack works. So say someone is trying to counter your time stretch with Disallow. You respond by casting Imp's Mischief, changing the target of Disallow to Imp's Mischief itself. Because Imp's Mischief goes on the stack last, it resolves first, and by the time Disallow resolves, its new target is no longer a legal target, so it fizzles, as they say. In other words, it's effectively countered. So Imp's Mischief can counter a counterspell, it can protect your permanence, and it can even steal an opponent's spell. Changing the target player of a time stretch to yourself is the ultimate move with Imp's Mischief, even though you lose 10 life. The reason I was considering this card is because most newer players don't understand how it works. However, it did not make the list because it does appear in more experienced players' decks, sometimes more competitive players' decks. But still, overall, I think it is underplayed. And our last honorable mention is Darkness. one black for an instant, prevent all combat damage that would be dealt this turn. This card is simple, but a fog effect can often turn the game in your favor. The only other black card like this I know of, anyway, is Sudden Spoiling, and both are great. Sudden Spoiling can't even be countered because it has Split Second. Sparing yourself a huge load of combat damage is basically the equivalent of gaining that much life. And if you wait to play Darkness at the perfect moment, you can get so much value out of it. It didn't make the top 10 because, again, even though it is underrated and underplayed, I still think it's a little more well-known and played than the cards that did make the list. So, let's get into the list, starting with the number 10 pick, Blood-Soaked Champion. One black for a 2-1 human warrior. Blood-Soaked Champion can't block, and it has Raid. So for one and a black, you return Blood-Soaked Champion from your graveyard to the battlefield. Activate this ability only if you attacked with a creature this turn. So Blood-Soaked Champion is one of many creatures that you can easily get back from the graveyard over and over again. And they are perfect for any deck that wants to repeatedly sacrifice creatures. Cards like Bloodghast and Reassembling Skeleton are the most popular choices, but I think Blood-Soaked Champion is just as worthy of inclusion. I use it in my Sequoir Deathkeeper deck to just keep making 3-1 Graveborn creature tokens every turn. Combine this with Vicious Shadows, another underplayed card, and you're going to be dealing tons of damage to your opponents. It's number 10 because it's not a super broken card in itself, but it does enable other cards to give you repeated value. And Vicious Shadows, by the way, is another underrated red card, just dealing damage to target player equal to the number of cards in that player's hand every single time a creature dies. The other day with my Sequoir Deathkeeper deck, I must have dealt something like 50-something damage with Vicious Shadows and just repeatedly sacrificing creatures. Anyway, the number 9 pick is Painful Quandary. 3 and 2 black for an enchantment. Whenever an opponent casts a spell, that player loses 5 life unless he or she discards a card. At first, your opponents won't mind paying the life so much, but eventually, they're going to get low on life, and at that point, they're going to hate this card, because it will be forcing them to discard every time they cast a spell. And once they're out of cards, they'll be forced to pay that remaining life, and they just won't be able to cast spells at all once they're low on life and low on cards. This is one of those permanents that has a big target on it from the get-go, and it can make you the enemy of the table, and that's why it's number 9. But if you can protect yourself against 3 other players, this will eventually lock some of your opponents out of the game. Number 8, we have Marilyn of the Mournsong. Marilyn is 1 and 2 black for a 2/3 elf wizard that says players can't draw cards. At the beginning of each player's draw step, that player loses 3 life, searches his or her library for a card, puts it into his or her hand, and then shuffles his or her library. So Marilyn is great in combo decks because she lets you tutor for whatever card you want every turn. Combine her with a couple extra turn spells, and your combo will be online in no time. The problem is that, of course, your opponents benefit from this as well. But if you use cards like Aven Mind Sensor, your opponents will only be looking at the top 4 cards of their library. If you use Obnixilus Unshackled, they will be taking 13 damage and sacrificing a creature every time they tutor with Marilyn. What else is great is that Marilyn herself will help you find these cards to lock the opponent out of the game. So I think Marilyn deserves more play. She also stops your opponents from drawing extra cards, which is going to be really annoying for them, and whatever is bad for your opponents is going to be good for you. I'm sure there are a ton of other cool tricks you can do with her if you just do a little research. Next. Number 7 is Sadistic Hypnotist, 3 and 2 black for a 2/2 human minion that says sacrifice a creature, target player discards 2 cards. Activate this ability only anytime you could cast a sorcery. One of the strengths of black is that it has great sacrifice outlets. The best sacrifice outlets don't cost you anything to activate. Not only is Sadistic Hypnotist a free and repeatable sacrifice outlet, but it also makes your opponents discard cards. And in a reverse sort of way, that equals card advantage, because you're ending up with more cards than your opponents. The question you might have is, why would I want to sacrifice creatures? And there are really many answers to that question. First off, you might have some infinite combo that requires a sacrifice outlet. Or maybe your creatures only do something when they die. Another reason to have a sacrifice outlet is to stop something your opponents want to do. For example, if your opponent wants to enchant your creature, exile your creature, make copies of your creature, gain control of your creature, or even if they just want to target your creature for some other reason, if you have a sacrifice outlet, you can sacrifice your creature instead. Finally, one of my favorite tricks to do with sacrifice outlets is to use spells like Insurrection, which temporarily gain control of my opponent's creatures. After I use the creatures, I sacrifice them before I go back to their owner's control. So that's what's great about sacrifice outlets. What's great about Sadistic Hypnotist is I think it is one of the most powerful effects you can get out of the free sacrifice outlet. Forcing your opponents to discard cards so easily can win you the game, especially if your deck is reanimation themed. Next is Yeheni, Undying Partisan. For 2 and a black, you get a 2/2 Aetherborn Vampire with haste. Whenever a creature an opponent controls dies, put a +1/+1 counter on Yeheni, Undying Partisan. Sacrifice another creature, and Yeheni gains indestructible until the end of the turn. Yeheni is also a free sacrifice outlet. He does not give you card advantage like Sadistic Hypnotist, but he does get huge and keeps himself alive. What made Yeheni steal the number 6 spot over Sadistic Hypnotist is his low casting cost and the fact that he has haste. In my mind, haste is basically an extra combat step, and if you can cast Yeheni on the same turn as some kind of one-sided board wipe, he is going to be getting in for a ton of damage out of nowhere. I've also seen him do awesome as a commander with cards like Grave Betrayal and anything that cares about death. So, number 5 on the list is Necrologia. 3 and 2 black for an instant. Necrologia can only be cast during your end step. As an additional cost to cast Necrologia, pay X life, and you get to draw X cards. So black has several other cards similar to this, but what I like about Necrologia is that it's a pretty straightforward deal. Pay X life, draw X cards. The downside of having to immediately discard to hand size is not hard to work in your favor if you are playing with some sort of graveyard strategy, but even if you aren't, you get to keep the best 7 cards out of a huge pile. When I play this in a life gain deck, I'm easily drawing 20 to 30 cards. It goes great in decks that play Living Death also. You draw 20 or more cards, discard all the creature cards, then get them all back from your graveyard onto the battlefield. Even if I'm not playing a life gain deck, this can easily draw me 15 to 20 cards in Commander. This is definitely a card I do not see people playing enough, so try it out. It's a lot of fun, and it can win you the game. Number 4 is Archfiend of Despair. It is 6 and 2 black for a 6/6 demon with flying. It says your opponents can't gain life, and at the beginning of each end step, each opponent loses life equal to the life that player lost this turn. So this card is kind of a combination of Erebos, God of the Dead, and Wound Reflection, but it is also a 6/6 flyer. Combined Archfiend's power with its ability, and it can all alone steal 12 life from an opponent just through combat. What takes this card to the next level is it works every time your opponents lose life. So if they are dealing damage to each other, or maybe casting Necrologia, whatever reason, all life lost to your opponents is effectively doubled. So for a red comparison, you could think of Arc Fiend as a combination of Leyline of Punishment and Gratuitous Violence, at least as far as damage to players is concerned. And anyone who has played Gratuitous Violence knows that it can be game-ending. One way you can end the game with Arc Fiend of Despair is to combine it with effects that have your opponent's life total, like Fraying Omnipotence or Quietus Spike. And that's why Arc Fiend takes the number 4 spot, because it's a bomb! Next, number 3 is Dread Cacodemon. Cacodemon is cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. Cacao! Yep, Cacao Demon. That's what I said. Alright, anyway, so this card is pretty dang sweet. Not only is it a one-sided board wipe, it's an 8-8 monster. I would say it's very comparable to Ingaric's Wake and Crush of Tentacles. I do think it is better than Ingaric's Wake because for just one more mana, you're ending up with an 8-8 creature. And I think it is better than Crush of Tentacles because it doesn't affect any of your permanents other than it taps down your creatures, which is really not a downside if you cast the Cacodemon after your combat step. They probably won't need to block because you've just destroyed all the potential attackers, and you still have an 8-8 blocker anyway, so the downside on Dread Cacodemon is practically nothing. If you are running Ingaric's Wake, you should be considering Dread Cacodemon as a replacement. Next, our number 2 pick is Bubbling Muck. 1 black for a sorcery that says, until the end of turn, whenever a player taps a swamp for mana, it produces an additional black mana. This card is fabulous in a great variety of decks. Essentially, for one phase, your swamps are doubled. Bubbling Muck is literally the black sorcery version of High Tide, an instant which is played in a lot of blue decks. I think Bubbling Muck is even better because you can combine it with Urborg, Tomb of Yawgmoth to double all of your lands. There are ways to turn all of your lands into islands, but I think Urborg is more reliable than those. Even with just a few swamps out, Bubbling Muck can give you a lot of extra mana for just one black. I use Bubbling Muck and High Tide both in my Kess deck. When combined with Thousand-Year Storm, you end up with tons of mana. So let's say, for example, you cast Thousand-Year Storm on turn 6, and you also have Kess on the battlefield. So on turn 7, you play your 7th land. Let's say it's Urborg, so now all of your lands are also swamps. Then 3 of your lands count as islands. So you tap one island to cast High Tide, and now your islands can tap for 2 blue. Next, you tap one swamp to cast Bubbling Muck, which is copied once thanks to Thousand-Year Storm, and now your swamps can tap for 3 black, and your island swamps can tap for 2 blue and 2 black. Remember that all of our cards count as swamps in addition to their other types. Next, tapping a swamp to float 3 mana, you use Kess to cast Bubbling Muck again from the graveyard, spending 1 of the 3 floating mana, leaving you with 2 floating black. This time, Bubbling Muck is being copied 2 more times with Thousand-Year Storm, so now your remaining swamps can tap for 6 black, and your swamp islands can tap for 2 blue and 5 black. Since you tapped only 2 swamps and 1 island to do this, you still have 2 swamps and 2 island swamps to work with. So now, including the 2 black you previously floated, you can float a total of 28 mana. So you end the game by casting something like Torment of Hailfire for x26, which, with Thousand-Year Storm, is going to be copied 3 more times, basically giving you a Torment of Hailfire where x is 104. This is just one example of how Bubbling Muck can generate you tons of mana. I'm sure you can think of more. And so now, for our number one pick, or my number one pick, for the top underrated black card, it's Crypt Incursion. Crypt Incursion is 2 and a black for an instant. Exile all creature cards from target player's graveyard. You gain 3 life for each card exiled this way. So this is not supposed to be the most powerful card on the list. Again, it's the most underrated card that's really powerful also. So for just 3 mana, this spell can easily get you like 30 to 40 life. On top of that, it exiles important creatures from your opponent's graveyard, and it's instant speed. So you can wait till your opponent thinks they are going to deal you lethal damage, or you can wait for them to start pulling creatures out of their graveyard with some combo, and then you Crypt Incursion, and it just ruins their day. I don't have any cards or decks to show you that this specifically synergizes with. It's just really good in any deck that has black. Literally, any deck with black can benefit from running Crypt Incursion, and that's why it gets the number one spot. It's an underrated card that can actually do really good in any deck if that decided to run it. It's a great way for black decks to gain back life that they spent doing things like drawing cards. It hoses down the opponent's graveyard strategy, and in a situation where your opponent thinks they are about to kill you, it can turn the game in your favor, just like a fog, giving you that extra turn you need to finish out the game on the swing back. I have never regretted drawing this card. I put it in almost all of my black decks, so try it out. You won't be disappointed. Well, that's it for today, Planeswalkers. Let me know what you think. What are some cool things we can do with these cards? What are your favorite underrated black cards? Keep your eyes on my channel for more top 10s and deck tech videos, and please subscribe. This is Eric from Bane Alley Magic signing off. Until next time, take care, take it easy.